you can want up. It says to me, just let's up in time. We'll be right back.
gentlemen, Will Wilde. Put your hands together. The
man
is in the house. Will, how are you doing, my friend?
I'm good, thanks. I'm good. Yeah.
Haven't seen you in a little while. This COVID business has torn us apart. We used to spend almost every day together on and
it
off.
It has been a while, hasn't it? Yeah. I can't believe it's been nearly a year now.
So, we've been working together for probably a good 10 years. We're taking music into the local primary schools, right?
Yeah. It's been my day job. My day job. Yeah. I wish you'd used a different video for that performance. I had to take my headphones out. I can't listen to myself from back then. It's like a different band, a completely different band now. I can't listen to myself from back then.
Well, do you know what? I mean, I hate listening to myself for sure, but I'm nowhere in your league. But that, I'm sure, to everybody else sounded absolutely phenomenal.
No, cheers.
And I mean, the stuff you're doing at the moment, and the videos you release on YouTube and so on, I mean, since we first met, you've just skyrocketed, you know, become an interstellar superstar. And you're coming today to talk to us about something in particular that has helped you out, I believe.
My presentation workshop, whatever you want to call it, is going to be about scales. I'm gonna start off with some scale theory stuff and explain the idea of scale formulas for anyone that's not familiar with that concept, and then talk about how to build all different types of scales. So, you know, major scales, minor scales, maybe some more kind of exotic scales if we have time at the end.
Well, I'll hand you over, Will. I'll back right. out, see, and then I'll gather afterwards. You'd be happy to meet folks in the bar.
In the bar
afterwards.
Rooms, all right. Yeah.
But okay, sign a few autographs for them. That kind
yeah.
of thing.
All right.
That'd be tremendous. If you need any help, give me a shout, but I'll be on standby. Enjoy. Folks, Will Wilde
nice
for
Thanks.
You.
All right. Hello. So I hope you're doing well, managing with this whole COVID thing. I know it's difficult, but so I'm going to be talking about scales. The reason I chose to do my workshop on this is because, you know, as harmonica players, we are primarily soloists. You know, that's what we do. We play solos, and for the most part, we improvise solos. And what do we, you know, how do we make solos? Well, by improvising around scales. So I think the most useful thing you can practice, the most useful thing you can spend your time learning with harmonica is scales. So that's what we're going to do. So I've made this little PowerPoint slideshow thing, so I'm going to take you through this. As I said, I'm going to start off with a bit of theory stuff. Don't worry if I know some people really aren't interested in the theory. I used to be one of those people too, so I get that. We will move on to some other stuff. I just want to get everyone playing and trying some of this stuff out. So here we go. I'm just going to share my screen with you. So I'm used to using Skype. I'm not too familiar with Zoom yet. How do I share my screen, Rich? I've clicked on share screen.
Share screen. Hang on. And then you have a white pop-up will show you various screens on your in the background, and then you say.
Oh, it's got. I clicked the arrow rather than the main bit. Yeah, I got it.
Yeah, good. The main Thanks. Green. That's it. We're,
nice
yeah, that's
one.
Good. That's good.
All right, cool. So like I said, I'm going to start with just a bit of theory about scale formulas. So you can think of scales as being like color palettes. Every scale creates a different kind of vibe, a different mood. So obviously like a major scale. It's going to give you that kind of happy sound, whereas a minor scale. It's going to give you a more kind of sad, haunting sound. Blues scale, obviously, is going to sound bluesy. So these are all in the same key. They're all in second position, but you can hear they're all very different. And then you get stuff like Phrygian dominant. Which, again, gives you a completely different sound. It's kind of Middle Eastern, Arabic kind of thing. So I'm going to show you how to make all these different sounds. So every scale has what we call a scale formula. And all scale formulas relate back to the major scale. So I've drawn out the major scale here in first position. I'm just going to be using a C harp for this whole thing, by the way. I know everyone has a C. So, you're probably all familiar with this. We've got... Okay. And we can number the notes in this major scale from 1 to 7. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1... 1, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. So that's the scale formula for the major scale. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And this top one is 1 again rather than 8 because we're back to C. Okay. Any questions so far? We're good? All right, cool. So I know a lot of harp players aren't, you know, too into their theory. So if you're someone who has sort of heard the term, oh, I'm playing the flat five here, or oh, that's a major seven, people kind of throw these terms around, and a lot of people don't really understand what they mean. So all that means is, if someone says, oh, that's, you know, that's the five, that means it's the fifth note in the major scale of whatever key we're in. So if we're playing something in the key of C, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, G would be the five. The flat five would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, flattened half a step, right? Major third, 1, 2, 3 would be E, and so on. So it's quite a simple concept, really. So like I said, every type of scale has a scale formula. So just as an example, the blues scale formula is 1, flat 3. It doesn't have a 2, no, it's just 1, flat 3, 4, flat 5, 5. It doesn't have a 6 in it, and then a flat 7. So if we take this C major scale here, we're in first position at the moment. So the 1, if we wanted to build a blues scale in the key of C, the 1 would be C, doesn't have a 2. Then we need a flat 3, which would be 1, 2, 3, an E, but flattened to E flat. Then we'd need a 4, which would be F, a flat 5, which would be G flat, 5 would be G, and then a flat 7 would be not a B, but a B flat. Okay. By the way, if anyone has any questions about anything at any point, please do ask. So, so you can see how you'd build a C blues scale. These would be the notes down here. And to play a blues scale in that middle octave in first position is extremely difficult because we'd need 1, 2, 3 overblows to get all those notes. We're not going to do that right now, but that's a reason why if you hear someone playing blues in first position, they don't really use that middle octave very much. Okay, so it's really useful to know this number system, but here we've got it in first position, and I imagine if you're like me, most of you probably, let's face it, play in second position the majority of the time. Most harmonica you hear, especially blues and rock country kind of stuff, is usually in second position. So it's really useful to know how the you know how these numbers lay out in second position. So let's take a look at that. I borrowed this this little diagram here from Richard Taylor. I've added some numbers to it. But yeah, if you want to see this diagram, it's on Richard's website, harpsurgery.com. So at the moment, you're probably looking at this thinking, Christ, that, you know, that's a lot of numbers. How am I going to remember all of that? You know, it looks pretty random. You know, 461, 461, 513. So it's not actually that complicated. We're going to work out this major scale in second position. So we'd go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. Okay, now we need an overblow there to get the major 7. Don't worry if you don't overblow. I'm not big into overblows. I prefer to have the notes there as, you know, standard notes or bends. So if you wanted to play this scale in second position, you could always go and get a country tuned harp, which has this flat 7 here tuned up to a major 7. But even if we're not going to use second position for playing this full major scale, it's useful to know it because then you know where the numbers lay out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. Okay, because that number system is the basis for all scale formulas. Okay, does that make sense so far? Just give me a thumbs up or something. Nice one. Cool. So if you want to know, that's the tab for the second position major scale there. Draw 2, 3 whole step, draw 3, blow 4, draw 4, blow 5, 5 overblow, blow 6. And again, we can number those 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1 by their scale degrees. An advantage of thinking of these notes as numbers or scale degrees as opposed to note names is that the numbers will be you know, relative to whatever key we're playing in. Okay, whereas if you remember them by note names, then you have to remember the note names for major scale in all 12 keys. Let's move on. Okay, so that was the full major scale. Like I said, it's got an overblow in it in second position. I know a lot of you probably aren't overblow players. That's cool. So there's a variation of this major scale that you'll hear used a lot in second position, which is the major pentatonic. Major pentatonic, as the name suggests, is just a 5-note scale. It's like a full major scale, but it emits the 4th and the 7th degree of the scales. It's a very jammable scale. You can play around with this over literally anything in a major key and it will work. It's very, you know, very safe. You can't really hit a wrong note here. So we're gonna use this one to start jamming with in a minute. So we can use this for anything in a major key, and you hear it used a lot in blues too. So I've written out the full major pentatonic here. Like I said, it's just like the full major scale, but without the 4th degree and the 7th degree. So instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, we're just going 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 1, 1, 6, 5, 3, 2, 1. Okay. So this is all the notes throughout, you know, all 3 octaves of the harp that are in this scale. I've highlighted the root notes in green. So we've got, so we've got one note, you know, above the root there that you can still use if you want. couple of notes there below the root. But when we're playing this, you want to think of these green notes here as being like your home base, okay? Because that's the root note of the key that we're playing in. Okay, so what we're going to do is use this scale. We'll move on to some other scales in a bit. But we're just going to use this scale to jam over some different backing tracks. So I know a lot of harmonica players kind of get scared of playing stuff that isn't blues. I'm not really sure why that is, to be honest. It's no different, really. We're just using the scale to make something up over a chord progression. So unless we're playing some like jazz or something progressive, you don't really need to worry too much about what's going on in the chords when we're using this scale. So I've picked a few different backing tracks, all in G major, and all in different styles. So we're going to start off with a kind of just kind of pop sort of kind of pop soul-y kind of thing. Then we might do a little country, maybe a fast kind of heavy rock one, and then maybe a blues one. But the concept is going to be pretty much the same for all of them. So all these backing tracks I'm going to use just straight off of YouTube. I'll tell you what they're all called if you want to make a note of that. Okay, so this first one is on YouTube. It's called G Major Guitar Backing Track Waterfalls by Tom Bailey Backing Tracks. So what I'm going to do is, to begin with, I'm just going to play the scale up and down. I'll take this first octave here from draw 2 to blow 6. Just play it up and down in time with the backing track to get a feel for it. Give me a thumbs up just to let me know you can hear that. Nice one, thank you. All right, so we want to find the pulse of the song. And we want to kind of just feel this groove. Helps to move to it if you can. Nod your head, tap your foot, whatever. And we're just going to play one note. And back down. So just one note per beat. Double time. All right. So, you know, you can hear already we're just going up and down a scale in time with the track, but it sounds pretty good, you know. Certainly none of those are wrong notes over these chords. I'm not sure what those chords are there. I think it's just, wasn't really paying attention. I think it's going back and forth between the 1 and the 4. It doesn't matter. We don't really need to know what the chords are, what the track's doing at this point. All the notes sounded good over it. Okay, so let's just let our ear tell us what sounds good and not worry too much right now about, you know, can I play this note over this chord? You know, why does this note work over this chord? You know, that's all interesting stuff to look into, but we're not going to be doing that in this workshop. We're just going to let our ear tell us if it sounds nice or not. Okay, so we've played the scale up and down. Sounds all right. What we're going to do now is the same thing, but instead of playing one note per beat, I'm gonna go from draw 2 up to blow 6 and back down. So I'm still gonna play the full scale in sequential order, but I'm gonna put some rhythm into it, okay? So I might stay on some notes a bit longer. I might make some notes a bit shorter. Sorry. right? And there's really no right or wrong to this. Like I said, just let your ear tell you what sounds good. So here we go. I'm going to turn this screen share off for a second. I just want to make sure you can see what I'm doing. And I've written the scale out on a bit of paper here. So what I'm going to do is point to the notes as I'm going up and down so you can see what I'm doing. All right. Here we go. Obviously, feel free to play along. Obviously, you won't be able to follow what I'm doing as I'm going along there, but you use the concept that I'm using and do your own thing with it. So we've tried playing the scale up and down to the beat. We've taken that a step further by putting some rhythm into the scale. The next thing we're going to do is mix it up a little bit more by not just going all the way from here to the other end of the scale. This time we're gonna move around it a bit more. So we might go la 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 la. Right. So I'm still only gonna move one step in each direction at a time, but instead of going all the way to the top and all the way back down, I'm just gonna move around. Try some stuff out. Let my ear tell me what sounds good. And you can try the same. Again, I'm gonna point to this so you can see what I'm doing. Okay, here we go. A little bit more freeform to the end there, but you can see, you know, obviously this isn't exactly how I would approach a solo like in real life, but it sounds, you know, it sounds pretty good. And all I'm doing is going up the scale a bit, coming back a bit, going up. If a note sounds nice, then I might stay on it for a bit, maybe add some vibrato. If I feel like going up in pitch, I'll just follow the scale up till I get to another note that sounds good. If I feel like coming down in pitch, I'll follow the scale down. So the scale is there to let us know what notes we can use, what notes are going to sound right over these chords. Okay. So as you get more comfortable with this, if you feel like it, remember the major pentatonic is just a full major scale, but with the fourth degree and the seventh degree taken out. So you can start to put those in as well. So the fourth degree of the scale was blow four, the major seven was a five overblow. If you're not an overblower, then you could get yourself a country tuned up, and then you'll have a major seven as draw five rather than the flat seven that's usually there. So let's try, and I'm going to do that. I'm going to use an alternate tuning because I'm not the best overblower. So yeah, let's try that. Start putting in the four and the seven. So I'm going to start off just playing the full major scale like we did to the beat. So cool, all of those notes fit with this track, so we're good to use them all. So now let's put some rhythm into it. Cool, all right, and now let's mix it up, be a bit less rigid. And you can try, you know, playing just with the major pentatonic for a bit, and then just with the full major scale for a little bit. And obviously, being two different scales, they have two different characters. There's a bit more harmonic information in the full major scale. So if you really want to emphasize that, then start to, you know, if you want to make it sound more major, then emphasize those notes that are in the full major scale that aren't in the major pentatonic. So that major seven and the four as well. Any questions so far? Nope. Okay.
Yeah, Will, there's a couple of things, just if I may. Can I put out a very, very special request? Because we've got folks joining us on Zoom, YouTube, around about an audience of 300 with us at the moment from all around the world. But one little boy who's in Haywards Heath called Tom Coleman has asked if you could give him a name check.
Oh, hey, Tom. How's it going? It's been a while. Tom's one of my students.
Yeah, he's tuned in and he's loving your work. Fabulous stuff. Someone else says, congratulations on your recent duo video with Rachelle Plus.
Oh, thanks.
Now, there's a lovely series that you've put out with your teamwork there, duo videos, isn't it? And someone's asked, when you're playing your long notes, are you conscious of changing with the bars or the timing in that respect, or you just go with your feel and sort of a more of a random or organic way?
I go with the feel with all of this stuff. It's good to, you know, learn theory and think about, you know, do some rhythm exercises and scale exercises when you're practicing. But when you're actually soloing, for me at least, you just go by ear. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. And then sort of if you've got the scales as your foundation, that gives you sort of the vocabulary and the freedom. And as you said earlier, you can sort of hang on to a note that really, you know, catches the moment.
Yeah. And the result is that all the stuff I just played there, I didn't play any licks. I mean, there were licks there, but I certainly wasn't just regurgitating licks I learned from this song and licks I learned from that song. It's more, you know, pure improvising, feeling your way around the scale, picking up on little things as you go. So having rhythmic ideas and using the notes of the scale to execute them.
I'm picking up on what you just said about your rhythmic ideas, because I know you also you have skills as a percussionist and drummer. So,
yeah.
You know, you got a good sense of rhythm and so on. But someone's asked, you know, are there any major rhythmic differences between playing blues and switching to rock?
Well, the main difference is that most blues is either a shuffle or it's in 6/8. So, you know, shuffles 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2. Whereas most rock is straight 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 2 3 4 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 2 3. So, yeah, it's just getting used to the rhythm. But that's the main difference, really.
And did I hear someone mention that kind of rock is based on classical music and
rock is born out of blues. Metal is born out of blues, classical.
Metal, that's but... right. Got you back to front. So yeah. And on that note, someone said here they absolutely adore your Freebird solo that you put out on YouTube. That took you some way. How long did it take you to master that?
I don't know, really. I mean,
how did you go about mastering it?
It was probably about a week at the beginning of lockdown when I didn't have much to do. All of a sudden, I started practicing harmonica again, and I hadn't really practiced harmonica for years. I just kind of played when I was in
you're too busy. You don't
on stage
to.
Or teaching. So I'd kind of had a mess around with Freebird years ago, and could kind of do it. Like, you can get all the notes because it's just major and minor pentatonics, but it never sounded right on an original, on a, you know, Richter. Mainly because of that, you know, blow six. So I thought, now I've got my wild tuning that I use. You know, it's got that. You can put the vibrato in the right places and you can get the intensity that it needs. So, yeah.
Well done. That's amazing. Maybe we'll come on to your tuning later on, because I'm sure people will be interested in that. But if you want to, maybe if you've got another scale or another section you wanted to move on to.
I'm going to blast through some stuff quickly here. So,
okay.
Right. I probably planned too much. So let's stick with this one just for a moment. Basically, the goal for everyone, or the goal for me at the end of this workshop, is for all of you to be able to improvise over anything, pretty much anything, like any backing tracks you're going to find, regardless of genre and regardless of them being major or minor. Okay, so we're going to go with another major track. Let's do something totally different to the last one. Let's do a fast rock thing. So let me just bring it up on here. This is going to be at 160 BPM, so it's pretty quick. Okay. So this is still G major. It's, you know, it's dressed up as a fast rock thing, but it's not really any different to solo over than the last track, other than, you know, we might want to play with a bit more intensity. So we can go back to the methods I just showed you. Take the major pentatonic scale. I'll just bring it up on the screen again. So we're going to go through the same steps as we did before. So we'll just take this octave here. And we're going to play first the scale up and down over the track. We'll find a pulse where it kind of fits. Here we go. Now, it's a fast track. That doesn't mean that we have to play fast. Right, we can subdivide that in half. So let's go. And back down. Cool. And then like we did before, we're gonna still play up and down that octave in sequence, but we'll put some rhythm into it. Okay, and then start to get more creative with the notes, move around a bit more and break out of just playing the scale. Then try adding in the major 7 and the 4, so 5 over blow and the blow 4 to make it a full major scale. See if that works. Nice. So two very different tracks there. I took the exact same approach really to both of them, and as you can see, it works. So that's the beauty of scales. And even if it's a scale, I still use this exercise with scales that I'm not so comfortable or familiar with. So I might take a weird scale. When I was messing around with yesterday was the double harmonic minor. Now, obviously, I don't have any licks in out of the double harmonic minor scale. I can't really think of any songs where there's a harmonica player using that scale, but that doesn't matter. You know, I can put on an appropriate backing track in the right key, play about with the scale up and down, and you know, so if you're unsure of how to play a certain scale, you can refer back to this. You can go to Google, type in Phrygian dominant or harmonic minor scale formula, or whatever scale it is you want to do, and it will tell you the scale formula. And then you find it here. So 1, flat 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. Okay, so let's move on. We've had a look at some major key stuff. What do we do if we want to play in a minor key? Can I have some answers in the chat, please? And actually, I've preempted some of the answers.
Someone said third position.
Position, yeah. Did anyone say panic?
Yeah, someone says change position, flat 5, someone's put in.
Change position, yeah. You could use a natural minor tuned harp. You could perhaps play in fourth or fifth position. They're common.
I think we've got the answer you might be looking for. Play third hole, half step, draw, bend, I mean.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So I see this question come up all the time in some of the harp forums on Facebook and stuff. And, you know, I've got to play a song in a minor key. What do I do? And usually the first answer someone will offer is, I'll play it in third position, or maybe play it in fourth or fifth position, or use a natural minor tuned harp. And they are all good options for playing minor stuff. And I use all of those options from time to time. But we don't have to. The thing is, as soon as you change position, these numbers here, the scale degrees, all change. So our 1 isn't draw 2 anymore. Our 1 would be like in draw 4 for third position, or it would be the draw 3 whole step bend in fourth position. So what happens is harp players get really confused and they never learn well, they never learn how the scale degrees are laid out, because every time they change position, they change, and it's really confusing. So what I recommend is just sticking with one position for a while. I like second best. I find it's the most intuitive, most comfortable, generally sounds best, and it still allows you to put some bluesy expression into everything. So if you learn a whole bunch of scales in second position, you really start to remember, you know, where all the scale degrees are laid out on your harp. So your root is always draw 2, blow 6, blow 9. Your major third is always in blow 3, draw 7, and so on. You know, your minor 6 is the 4 overblow or the 8 blow bend. I hope you're still with me. So we're going to stay in second position and do some stuff in a minor key. Now, most of you, in fact, probably all of you, already know a minor scale of sorts in second position, because guess what? The blues scale is a minor pentatonic scale with a flat 5 added in there. Okay, so just like we took the full major scale and we stripped it back to a major pentatonic, you can take a full minor scale and strip that back to a minor pentatonic. And the blues scale is just the same thing as a minor pentatonic, but it has this additional note added in here. Draw 4 bend, which is the flat 5. So you can use this scale over most stuff in a minor key, because essentially it is a minor scale. So let's take a look at a full, you know, complete natural minor scale first. Its scale formula is 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, flat 6, flat 7. So let's make this bigger. So the only difference between a major scale and a minor scale, a natural minor scale, is that the 3rd, 6th, and 7th note are flatted. So instead of 1, 2, 3, we get 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay. So that's the minor third or the flat third. Let's keep going up and flat the 6 and 7 as well. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, flat 6, flat 7, 1, 1, flat 7, flat 6, 5, 4, flat 3, 2, 1. Okay. So by just flatting those three notes, we completely change the feel from a major scale to a minor scale. And they're both in second position as well. For anyone that wanted that. By the way, I'm going to put these tabs and things up onto my artist profile page on the Harpin by the Sea website later today. Cool. So we're going draw 2, draw 3 whole step, draw 3 half step for that minor third, blow 4, draw 5, 4 overblow for the flat 6, draw 5 is a flat 7, and then blow 6 is our root or our 1 again. Again, if you're not an overblow player, you could use a natural minor tuned harp for this. Basically, that will give you a minor 6 as your note in blow 5 instead of the major 6, which is usually there. And draw 3 is flattened for you, so you don't have to bend it. Okay. So we're just like the major scale has a stripped back major pentatonic. The minor scale has a stripped back version, which is the minor pentatonic. You're probably all familiar with this. So the minor pentatonic emits the 6, which is handy if you're not an overblow player. It means you don't need to overblow anymore. And it emits the 2nd degree of the scale, which would be the draw 3 whole step. Again, it's an extremely jammable scale, and you can use it over pretty much anything in a minor key and in blues, including minor blues. So this is all the notes in the minor pentatonic that you can use on the harp, with the root notes highlighted in green. And we're going to try this now over some backing tracks, just like we did with the last scale. Let's go with a kind of Pink Floyd-y, bluesy rock thing. All right. Okay, so I'm gonna start again by just let's realize there was no point in me pointing to the pointing to the things on this bit of paper before. I could do it with the mouse on it. So sorry, I put the flat five in there. We're going minor pentatonic, not blues at the moment. Let's try that again. So if we draw two, three. So already I'm starting feeling myself really itching to break out of just playing one note per beat and wanting to kind of play with this a bit more. So that's what we're going to do next. You can add the flat five in here as well, which is that draw four bend. Now remember, the draw four bend or the flat five is the only difference between a minor pentatonic and a blues scale. If you're finding, like I did at the beginning there, you keep playing the flat five by accident, then try and force yourself not to and just play this minor pentatonic, because this is a different scale. It creates a different vibe, a different feeling. When you do decide to put that flat five in there, because that's the note that makes this, you know, makes the blues scale distinctive from the minor pentatonic, then that is the note to emphasize, or, you know, to roast or milk, right? So if you want to make this sound really bluesy, lean on the flat five. I'm going to show you what I mean. Okay, so minor pentatonic. So you can hear as soon as I start leaning into that draw four bend, it gets extra bluesy. It's a nice backing track. So there you go. Now another approach you can use, as well as just, you know, playing the scale with rhythm and sort of moving up and down the steps of the scale. This was something I heard Jason Ritchie mention once in a YouTube video or live stream video. He made this kind of analysis to a drum kit approach. So if we simplify this down, instead of using the whole octave of the scale, let's take the first three notes here. So draw two, draw three, half step, and blow four. And instead of thinking about those as three notes, three melodic notes, think about those as being three drums on a drum kit. So you might have a snare drum, a rack tom, and a floor tom. Okay. And for the purpose of this exercise, I want you to completely limit yourself to these three notes, okay? So the one, the flat three, and the four. Even if you want to play, start wanting to play some other notes, don't play them. Again, if you find you can't do that without adding other notes in there, then that tells you that the harmonica's playing you. You're not playing it, right? People fall into these like muscle memory. Like play the same shapes all the time. And we're trying to break out of that. So we're going to restrict ourselves to these three notes, and we're going to try and make as many different ideas out of them as possible. Okay, so we're basically eliminating melody from the equation and focusing on rhythm now. Okay, I'll show you what I mean. So we got draw two, draw three half step, low four. Cool. Now, I didn't know that was going to happen in the backing track there, so I'm listening and reacting to it. So it got quieter, so I got quieter. I kind of anticipated that something was going to, you know, it was going to drop and go heavy again at some point, so I held on to that middle note, and then when it did drop, I kind of fell back to the root. So that's a really cool exercise to try. Just restrict yourself to a few notes, make up different rhythmic patterns with it. Now, if you struggle to do that, you can practice this without a harmonica, just when you're driving or whatever, by just making up little rhythms. So let's come up with a rhythmic phrase. That's our pulse. So if I go da 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 da, just as a random example, da 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 da, da 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 da, and we're going to put that rhythm on different notes. So that was just random, really. I chose this rhythm and then I just tried starting it in different places and tried to randomize the notes, you know, using the scale as a guide of which notes were safe. So I came up with, I don't know, 20 different licks there, all with the same rhythm, but, you know, I'm making these licks up on the spot rather than trying to remember a bunch of someone else's licks and you know, reinterpret them. It's more kind of pure improvising, which is what we want to do. So, to summarize what we've done so far, how are we doing on time, by the way? Do we have to finish right on 6 o'clock?
We need to be fairly, yeah, we're not totally flexible. We've got a little bit of leeway, Will, but if okay. You
wanted, yeah. Just... All right, I planned more than I'm going to fit in here. But so for major keys, you can use the major pentatonic and then maybe try the full major scale. For minor keys, use the minor pentatonic and then try adding in the other two notes to make it a full minor scale. For blues, talking about you know, standard kind of blues shuffle rather than a minor blues. Whoops. You can use both the major pentatonic and the minor pentatonic or blues scale. If it's a minor blues, then stick to minor scale or minor pentatonic blues scale. So this is an area where people get confused. So major key, major scale, minor key, minor scale makes perfect sense. A lot of blues, we can play major pentatonic or minor pentatonic. And the reason for that is a basic major chord, major triad is made of a 1-3-5, right? Which means we have to play major thirds over the top. If we don't, it clashes and it sounds horrible. Difference between that major chord and a minor chord is the third is flattened. So we have to play minor thirds. If you play a major third over that, it'll clash. Now blues, I'm not talking about minor blues here, but most blues shuffles, they're playing like a G7 chord, C7, D7, which is basically a major triad, but with a flat 7 in the chord as well. Right. And having that flat 7 in the chord, don't ask me how, but magically, it destabilizes the chord somehow and allows us as soloists to play major or minor thirds over the top. So when we're talking about a blues shuffle, typical blues shuffle, you can use both the major and the minor pentatonic scales. Okay, I'll show you a little bit what I mean there. Oops. Let's go with this one. This is the first one that came up on YouTube. Backing track, Blues in G. Got a picture of John Lee Hooker on it. So I'll start with the blues scale. I just play it up and down. 2, 3, 4. So you can hear that what sounds cool over this. Now major pentatonic. So you can hear those notes all work too. Now what most people tend to do, or a lot of people tend to do, is kind of use all of those notes at once. In the same lick or in the same phrase. And that, there's nothing wrong with that. That's totally fine. Little Walter, a lot of other guys did that. But it's good to know your major pentatonic and know the blues scale or the minor pentatonic. And then you have a bit more control over the vibe or the mood or feel that you're creating. And like I said before, look for the notes that are in the blues scale that aren't in the major pentatonic scale and vice versa. Those are the notes to emphasize, to bring out the character of each scale. Okay. So major pentatonic and blues scale both have, you know, they both have a root. They both have a fifth. So if you're spending all your time on the fifth and the root, there's not really much harmonic information there. But if you're thinking about it a bit more, okay, the blues scale has a flat 5 and a minor third. So I'll accent or emphasize those notes and that's going to make it sound bluesy. And okay, the major pentatonic has a 2 and a major third. And a major sixth. So if you emphasize those notes, it's going to bring out more of that major pentatonic sound. Okay.
Well, I'm going to have to cut in there,
yeah,
buddy. A lot of people are saying that they've absolutely thoroughly enjoyed and been enlightened by what you're saying. Very good and informative, food for thought. Very cool. Informative as usual. Thank you. Many thanks for a great workshop. I was going to suggest, if you're free to visit to chat to people afterwards in the breakout room,
that
would be one suggestion. Another one, obviously, people can come to you direct for lessons, right?
Yeah, that's a good point. I do teach on Skype. Obviously, at the moment in the pandemic, I'm not gigging, so I've got.
Also, I was going to suggest perhaps I could invite you to the harp surgery to do an intermediate workshop with us there along the way, and we could continue this theme there.
Yeah, sure. Sounds good.
We're going to have to pull things to a close now, Will, because we've got our friends are waiting, ready to join us from Hohner Harmonicas in Trossingen.
Okay.
So I think we're going to have to run the VT shortly, but that has been really, really clear and really, really helpful. It's so great to put it to those backing tracks and see how you just develop the vocabulary into grammatical phrases and sentences, as I call it. A really, really superb job. So thank you ever so much for joining us again.
Thanks
for your
having
third
me.
This is your third stint at Harpin by the Sea.
It is, yeah. Can I just say, by the way, big thank you to Richard and Russ and everyone else involved in this event for making this happen, despite the pandemic. How about a round of applause for all the organisers?
It's our pleasure, Will, and we'll do everything we can to make sure you're looked after. Everyone's digging deep, because obviously all the artists around are really struggling at the moment. So we'll do everything we can to help you, my friend. So stay safe, won't you? Don't go falling off your bike again. And I hope to see you again very, very soon, Will. Do join our friends in the breakout room. Go and join them there. And ladies and gentlemen, please put your, I'll reciprocate, please put your hands together for the very, very special, our very own Will Wilde. Thank you so much, Will.
Cheers, Richard. Thanks, everyone.
Okay.
Appreciate
it.
Thanks for tuning in.
Take it easy. Okay.
Have a good weekend.
Cheers, and to you, brother. Okay, so very shortly we're going to have our lovely friends from Hohner Harmonicas in Trossingen, Germany, joining us. So Uncle Russ, can I ask you, please, would you be kind enough to run VT?
All right, this one's called Low Down Dirty Blues. I got them low down. just to make ends meet. The tax man took all of my money. He left me out there on the street. It's so lonely. Whoa!